You unlock this door with the key of imagination. Beyond it is another dimension. A dimension of sound. A dimension of sight. A dimension of mind. You are moving into the land of both shadow and substance, of things and ideas. You've just crossed over into... We... Lollacost.
Used to make Final Fantasy, they used to break new ground. They spent it all on vanity shits and had to be bailed out. You think that they play it real straight, but they don't even care. They've sold 7 million, lost 30 billion yen. They still don't know what's going wrong. It's shit to be square. It's shit to be square. They like their Gucci business suits and 80-inch TVs. They're making Final Fantasy X3 with 7-hour cutscenes. They tell me Tomb Raider's good, but I don't even care. The balance sheet's crazy, the bottom line's nowhere. There is no denying that. It's shit to be square. It's shit to be square. Shit to be square. So shit to be square.
We are the Lollacost.
How the hell do you sell someone a new car when they've already got a car which gets them from A to B?
Girl, please, let me stick my key in your ignition, babe, so I can get this thing started and get rolling, babe. See, I'll be doing about 80 on your freeway. Girl, I won't stop until I drive you crazy. So buckle up, cause this can get bumpy, babe. Now hit the lights and check out all my functions, babe. Girl, back that thing up so I can wax it, baby. Honey, we gon' mess around and get a ticket, babe. Cause we off up in this Jeep.
I needed some help all of 30 minutes before we started recording. I was there in the shower, getting all clean, getting all soapy. And turned the shower off. Went to walk backwards toward the sloping end of the bath, of which I was standing in, to step out, and the inevitable happened. I did a Scooby-Doo dance on the spot, fell on my arse, and then slid the whole length of the bath down towards the tap end in the fetal position.
I have to say, that's just the worst thing I've ever heard. You are a Spreaker.com professional broadcaster, Hawk. Don't ever let me hear you end a sentence with a proposition again. The bath in which you were standing. Not the bath you were standing in.
Here we go.
Here we go.
The English teacher's back.
And we go.
And we wouldn't have it here any other way, would we?
For me, have you ever driven a stick, babe? You be screaming every time we shift them gears, babe. So brace yourself while I'm hitting them corners, babe.
Let's do that.
Microsoft says that E3 is going to be all about the games, baby.
Apparently, yeah. Seems to be a lot of noise around Microsoft at the moment.
Game, the Xbox train runs on all games.
Baby.
Yes. Is it a backhanded, you know, kind of slap at Nintendo? So like, we're bringing some games out, unlike some companies.
I don't think they need to do that, though, do they? So I'd discount that.
Are the big two... Well, the big one and a half, now Sony's going down the shitter. Getting cold feet about a new generation. What do you think?
they can smash out a higher performing console, but nothing's really gonna. There's nothing people are gonna get excited about. Even screenshots and in-game videos are not really gonna get people excited because they're not really gonna be that much of a progression for what we've got at the moment. That's the long and the short of it. So how do you get people excited? You just go, "Fuck yeah! Come on, everybody! Who can shout the loudest? It's the Microsoft presentation for the next Xboxy thing. Woo, 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 yeah!" Something like that, anyway.
And key change.
Now let me see you.
Woo, 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 yeah. Oh my god. That was a worse key change than Living on a Prayer.
Now, usually I don't do this, but
But everyone needs something new to play on. Everyone needs something a little bit more, with a bit more grunt and a little bit more flexibility. And how the hell do you sell? It's like the car industry. How the hell do you sell someone a new car when they've already got a car, which gets them from A to B?
That's a very, very good analogy for it, actually. I was just about to talk about how, you know, we're living in some pretty awful times at the moment. People are actually having to choose between heating their house and eating at the moment. So
we're living in terrible times, times where people really have to take the difficult decision to eat or to buy a Wii U game.
My point is that convincing people to buy proprietary hardware is going to get harder and harder and harder from here on in. It's not a case that every console generation that comes out is going to be a quantum leap forward from the last one anymore.
Yeah.
There is not going to be an appreciably better product from generation to generation from here on. It's going to run on ideas. And yeah, I'm not discounting the next generation. I think the ideas that I've heard bandied about are pretty good. I really like the idea of being able to hit a button on my controller and broadcast a Let's Play to YouTube.
Yeah,
on the go.
You would, wouldn't you? You would.
I will, I must point out, spend the whole Let's Play playing Metal Gear and wanking. I was going to talk about the Wii U and its lack of games, because Electronic Arse has said it has no games in development for the Wii U whatsoever. Which is kind of scary, but, you know, EA has been pretty diplomatic about it. They've said it's not by any means a policy decision, that they continue to maintain good relations with Nintendo as a company, and the last 30 years should teach you you should never count Nintendo out, you know. Well, you know, that sounds pretty reasonable, doesn't it, Hog? And then there's Twitter. Oh, lordy, lordy. Why in God's name do they continue to allow company employees to have their own Twitter accounts?
Here we go. Right. Yes. So,
The individual to be named and shamed today is Bob Somerville, who is apparently an architect for EA Sports.
Bob Somerville's the name. I've just come round to do your gardening. As well, yeah, as talk to you about being an EA employee.
When I read these tweets to you, Hawk, I'd like you to, you know, to play the other end of the spectrum here. I'd like you to try and imagine these tweets in the most charitable and open-ended way you can imagine. Okay, you ready?
I'll try as much as I can.
Okay.
This move is an utterly intentional attempt to place company resources on markets that actually matter. Wii U is crap. Nintendo are walking dead. Historically, third parties have always performed poorly on Nintendo platforms. Mario and Zelda are the only things that make money. Nintendo are operating like it's 1990, and by now they really should have done a Sega.
Is he really an employee, by the way, this person?
You wouldn't know it from his Twitter feed, because all evidence of his employment has suddenly disappeared along with all his tweets. It's one of the things I love about these stories. They remind me of the start of The Running Man, where one of the prisoners panics and breaks rank, and the prison guards activate his kill switch on his explosive collar. The companies are saying that everything is fine, nobody is rioting. And then one of the employees goes, "It's all lies! Killian is lying to you!" And they go, beep, 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 beep.
I don't think his tweet is anything to be... I don't think anybody is shocked by what he's saying in his tweet. It's gonna kick the Wii U in the nuts, but it's not like the Wii U's really
got any
good
nuts
games
left.
Well, it's a girl anyway, isn't it?
It's a good question, actually. I'd never thought of consoles in terms of gender.
The GameCube, that was particularly androgynous in its purple. What gender was that?
I don't know. I always found the PC Engine to be pleasingly unthreatening.
A Jaguar. The Atari Jaguar, that was a guy. That was a dude.
Definitely. The Atari Jaguar was a douchebag.
Yeah, the PS1. Again, that was kind of some kind of ladyboy, almost. Kind of light-coloured, smooth-skinned, hairless.
Did look particularly metro.
Obviously, Xbox One. That's a high school jock of a console.
I think it's a couch potato.
You think? I thought it was a high school jock who liked... at the corner of his eye in the showers after a game, kind of looking at the other guy's cocks. PS2? What the fuck is that? That's like the Grace. That's like the Grace Jones. You know it's female, but you wouldn't mind being bummed by it.
I'm prepared to change the subject entirely.
It was the Grace Jones thing, wasn't it? I can see you getting aroused. I can see you through the internets.
Can we change the subject before I have to sit down and place an iPad strategically in my lap?
Yes.
Hello, I'm a man, I work in a video shop. I'm the man for the video shop.
Re-record, not fade away. Re-record, not fade away. Re-record, not fade away.
This week, I want to talk to you fine people about some special extras. Now, I'm not talking about the usual special features you find on DVDs and Blu-rays nowadays. No, instead, I want to talk to you about the things we find in the cases when the films are brought back or when items are traded into us. Warning, some of the following stories may turn your stomach, so or listen at your peril, whatever. This week, I had the misfortune to be presented with a moral dilemma while processing some trade, details of which will follow. Got me thinking about some of the things I found inside cases while checking items or accepting trade. Here are the five oddest things we found in film or game cases while checking or processing stock. The top five oddest extra stuff left in cases ever. Number five, a human tooth, a genuine human tooth. The tooth of a five-year-old girl, as it happens, it was left inside a case with a Mickey Mouse DVD after it fell out one night. Little girl went to put it somewhere safe. Not as gruesome as it could have been. I've seen my kids produce teeth with a bit of nerve hanging off before. As I found it while the girl was in the shop with her mum, I quickly popped a 50 pence piece from my own pocket into a small envelope, signed it with the Tooth Fairy logo, put the tooth in a separate envelope, handed one with the coin to the little girl, who cried happily on the spot, while her mum secreted the tooth into a handbag and thanked me. It's a nice ending, really. And number four, a selection of body hairs and sweat. We have this one customer comes in on a motorbike, and in the summer he's usually, as far as he's told us, I've not seen, naked at all but his leathers. He usually tucks his rental cases inside his leathers. It doesn't bode well on a hot day. Indeed, we once had a film come back for him. He apologetically handed over sweat and hair encrusted. I put it to one side and left it for the night shift. I also suggested the customer refrain from doing it in the future. He did as requested. We all won. Number three passports. This one was brilliant. As we opened up the case to be presented with three passports, I was opening the shop. I found him in a case that had been placed in our Dropbox the night before. Almost as if planned, I looked up from the counter to see a harassed young lady pressing her face up against the door, mouthing the word passport at me. Turns out they're due to leave on a holiday that morning. While sorting out DVD rental, she's accidentally picked up the passports with the disc and sent the whole lot packing. Looking for her, I got in early that day. They had a great holiday, and then her boyfriend did fall off of a boat. He didn't die, but he fell off. Number two, 43 finger or toenail clippings. Yes, I counted 43. That's more nails than digits, and obviously disgusting. We threw them away, guessing the previous renter probably wouldn't need them back. Uh, At number one is erotic fiction involving various CBeebies presenters. It was handwritten. Yeah, I'm not really sure what to say here. The description doesn't already cover, but in essence, it was pure filth involving some of Britain's most beloved pre-loved television personalities. I only read half the first page before I decided it's far too weird. It was handwritten in red biro. Needless to say, I can no longer watch those programmes without that filth interfering with my viewing.
Ooh.
So there you go, a window into the world of the extra. I've heard all manner of stories from colleagues, ranging from medication to a monocle, illicit drug paraphernalia to photographs of anatomy. Sometimes if the customers do it on purpose, other times it's too creepy to even consider it being intentional. But going back to my original mention of the trade incident this week, I'll leave you with a story of how I saved the modesty and possibly a lot more of a teenager. Kid comes in the store with some family members, this included his mum. In one of the game cases I was checking, I found a soiled contraceptive tied up and secreted inside the manual of a game. The neck wasn't inside the case and flopped over as I opened it. I looked up and met the panicked stare of a teen who knew what it was. He looked at me with a look that suggested, "Please, please, that's my mum over there. If she sees it, I'll just die inside. I'm begging you, please help me out of this situation. I need your help." Immediately, my mind thought, "Go on, take it out, hold it up, ask if he wants to keep it." Luckily, I was a teenager once long ago, and I knew I could help. I closed the case, put it to one side, pretend I'd never seen it. I waited till I left, disposed of it appropriately, all the while smiling at the thought of what that lad will always owe me one. So there you go, discretion and consideration. That was a good day for customer service. I always do a good line in Double Bag in the Twilight films when blokes rent them. Should really get some plain brown paper bags for those guilty pleasure rentals. Right, seeing some kids open a bag of popcorn, spread it all over my shop, so I should toddle off and clear it up. See you next time. So-
Re-record, not fade away. Re-record, not fade away. Re-record, not fade away.
Right, give me 1 second to refresh myself.
Did you not do that over the Grace Jones section earlier?
I've never really seen the Grace Jones thing. I really haven't. It's just... have you seen Vamp?
I was going to say, if you've seen Blade, starring Denzel Washington, you've effectively seen the nocturnal persona of Grace Jones.
Denzel Washington, that's quite correct.
Did I say Denzel Washington?
Yes.
Oh, God.
Snipes.
Snipester. Oh, dear. I'll put that down to my fall in the bath earlier. Although...
Dr. Hancock in Legends of the Fall in the Bath.
Hey, I've got a little something for you. I didn't actually say that just so I could put the track in. I've got a few Reddit letters for you, so you can catch your breath. Let me throw a few and see if any stick. These are letters from the Reddit and Ulster Advertiser, a local newspaper from my hometown. Well, we've done a couple of these previously. The first one is entitled, "Come on, put the rubbish bin back." Come on, put the rubbish bin back. A number of months ago, Redditch Borough Council, for a still unknown reason, decided to remove the litter bin at the Studley Road bus stop nearest to the Tesco Express shop. As a result, a large number of Redditch citizens now do the only thing possible when faced with the prospect of a stamina-sapping 20-yard journey to the next available bin. They throw their rubbish on the ground and expect someone else to pick it up. The result? The council street cleaners now face many times more work in this area than they did in the past. Come on, Redditch Borough Council, wake up and smell the coffee! You have to realise that a sense of community and concern for the environment is sadly lacking in a lot of people today. I say, replace the bin. That was from Michael Stevens, Studley Road in Redditch.
You know how some people choke themselves to make it more intense when they have a wank?
No.
Oh, come on, you must do. I mean, that bloke from NXS died. That's how David Carradine died.
Oh, yeah, Carradine.
It's how Sonic the Hedgehog will eventually die.
What do you mean, eventually die? Anyway...
That's the effect that these letters have on me, just listening to how small other people's concerns are. I'm smoking an e-cigarette while you read this, But listening to you read these letters out, this e-cigarette, it feels like a fatty boom batty.
Starting to look
feels like a Camberwell carrot.
This is likely to get you very high indeed.
Who says it's a Camberwell carrot?
I do. I invented it in Camberwell, and it looks like a carrot.
Here's a little one for you. Let's see what carrots this grows. Boy 6 was sold an empty box. This is from Charles Harborne in Win Yeats in Reddit.
Not Charles Dickens.
No.
Boy 6 was sold an empty box.
Charles
that's a Bleak House joke, and if you don't get it, I don't fucking care. Because that's the way the voice of sex rolls.
I think the voice of sex... Fucker. One thing I noticed was that you dropped out of character about 3-4 episodes ago, and I don't think you realised. I think you were just rolling with it. Anyway, Boy 6 was sold an empty box. To the so-called lady who sold my 6-year-old grandson a Meccano set at the Studley car boot sale, he was full of excitement and could not wait to get home and build it, only to find on opening the box it was empty. Now I know it was cheap, but that does not excuse this cold-hearted act. An adult can expect this and accepts that this happens, but a child, shame on you.
I also once experienced disappointment as a result of a business transaction with a so-called lady.
You think? Excuse me if I'm being a bit thick, and this is obvious to everybody else. If you buy an empty box, it kind of feels like an empty box.
I would congratulate whoever has raised that child on utterly crushing the joy and imagination out of them. Because what kind of fucking kid gets given a present and doesn't open it until they're home?
On launch day, Kotaku will be covering a story.
Kotaku.
Kotaku. Is that better?
Sounds like an Ewok name. Wicket and Kotaku.
Double fell. Don't pick me up on my fake Japanese bullshit. Thanks for picking me up. So on Microsoft's launch day, this story will run again. Boy 6 was sold an empty box. Boom, boom. Pick up.
I see what you did there.
Yeah, got there eventually. You know how it works with me. Pick up that horse muck, says DK French in Headless Cross.
No, let's move on.
I have just taken the dog out for its daily walk around the paths of Headless Cross and came across where a horse...
The paths of Headless Cross. Surely that's a Nine Inch Nails album title.
It's an old Hammer horror film. And came across where a horse had relieved himself.
He came across it.
He came across a horse, apparently.
It's a bit racy this week, isn't it?
There was horse manure all over the pathway, right next to a school. Us dog owners have to pick up our dog mess, and rightly so. This should be the same for horse riders. Better still, they should be banned from these paths. This, in my opinion, is double standards.
So far, we've had she-males tricking Boy 6. And now we've got coming across horse manure in public. This sounds like an average weekend for me. I'm digging it. Where is this from again? I want to move there.
The paths of Headless Cross.
Lollacourse Literary Masterclass presents The Day the Men Found Love, a tale of sexy, sexy Batman time. By Comics Nix. Bruce Wayne was paying a visit to Detroit City because a cousin of him was very sick, so Bruce went with his chauffeur there, but was very cautious because he took his batsuit with him. When the chauffeur arrived with the limo, Bruce got out of the car and entered Cousin Oliver building. It was a very tall and dark place full of gargoyles and lighted torches all over the wall. As Bruce went up the stairs, he noticed the handrail was full of a strange white sticky goo. Maybe it's hair gel, he thought.
The stairs creak very much, and looks like the place is going to fall apart. Then Bruce Wayne found Cousin Oliver's room in the last floor of the building. But something was strange. The door was open, and incense's stench was flowing out of the room. Bruce ran inside the fast he could, with the heart throbbing in fear of something bad. And it was. Cousin Oliver was naked, on four on the ground, with his arse filled with cheap trash burning incense. Bruce Wayne then went down the other side and saw Oliver's eyes, bulging and bleeding, and something strange scared on his forehead. "Damn, those bastards killed Oliver. I must go to the cops," said Bruce, shooting a photo and collecting the incense's copy from the cousin butt. He closed the door of the apartment and went to the police station. When Bruce arrived at the police station, he told the cops what happened, but they just didn't care. Corruption was prevailing on Detroit City, and no only gives a damn. "All right, let me talk with the commissioner," said Bruce to the fat cop in front of him. "I don't think so. The commissioner is dating a whore, and I don't want to disturb," answered the pig-faced cop with a cigarette on his mouth. "All right, say that Bruce Wayne's been here," and Bruce started to walk away. "What? Commissioner Bruce Wayne is here," shouted the fat arse pork. The commissioner emerged with a whore by his side. His eyes got big and he went to shake hands with Bruce. "Mr. Bruce, what a pleasure. What brings you here?" "Looks like you put to good use the money I donated last year. Your slut is very beautiful." The commissioner adjusted his tie and swallowed a gob. "Mr. Wayne, I can explain." "Don't need. I just want to report a murder. My cousin got killed in his apartment." "My God, Mr. Wayne, who could do that?" "I don't know. This is why I need you to discover." "Don't be afraid, Mr. Wayne. We have the best detective here on precinct. He is our most awesome cop in activity." "RoboCop, come here." The giant metallic bionic man emerged from an obscure room in the back of the building. The pumping metallic steps was very distinct, thought Bruce. "So you're the best they have, isn't it?" said Bruce. "Yes, Mr. Wayne, I can kill in 500 million different spots on the human body," answered the metallic cop. "Okay, let's go. I want you to solve a mystery with me." This is when they hear a scream outside the window. A woman is hanging outside the building, grabbing a gargoyle and almost falling to the ground. Bruce hears that, but RoboCop is there. How could Batman save the woman? Bruce then says, "RoboCop, use the phone and call the fire department." "I don't need phone, I have direct combat." "Now I'm fucked," thought Bruce. The woman screamed again, but this time she was falling. Bruce had no time to think. He picked his mask, put it on in front of RoboCop, and jumped from the window. The woman was in shock, so Batman took her to a room and knocked on the door. As the resident opened the door, Batman raced to the top floor again, without being seen. "You saw everything, RoboCop." "Yes, and when I come back to the precinct, they will extract my memories and analyze, discovering your identity." "Holy fuck! Are you going to arrest me?" "No. You are an agent doing vigilante work in a city where cops don't abide the law. I defend law, not the system." "There is a way to extract your memories before they know everything?" "Yes, but it will involve your masculinity. When I fuck, my memory's backup is ejected from my butt, and we can delete what is important to preserve your identity." "Alright, RoboCop, but let's go to a motel. I don't want to violate my cousin's private space." "There is a problem, Bruce. I'm not with my penis now." "What? Why you're not with it?" "Because today is a work day. I only attach my mechanical penis at weekends." "That's going to be a problem. Let's go to the precinct so you can pick it up." "Impossible. They only liberate its use at Friday nights, and I must return them at Monday morning." Bruce Wayne then put on his Batman suit to prepare mentally for the demanding task. He must now discover a way to make sex with RoboCop, because it's Monday. All right, RoboCop, we must find something to attach in your crotch. Let's search the garbage. Batman and RoboCop entered a dark alley and started to look in the trash for some phallic object that could be attached. Batman said, "Look, RoboCop, it's a flashlight. Do you think you can use it?" "It's too small, Batman. I need an 8-inch good metallic part. This shit is made of plastic." Batman searched more, but to no use. Batman then remembered his bat utility belt. He reached for it and found a bat smoke grenade, cylindric, 8-inched, and a good titanium metal cover. "RoboCop, I found it, but you must be very gentle or you could pull off the grenade pin." RoboCop picked the grenade, attached in his crotch, and red lights got immediately red on the grenade's body. "It means I'm very excited, your ass is very round, and I love leather-clad men." "But now, RoboCop, we need lube, and I don't have any, only boot grease." "We can use my lubricant oil. It's a bit old and need a change, so there's no problem wasting it." RoboCop pushed a button on his left buttock, liberating a good dose of oil on his penis grenade. "This grenade is very large, RoboCop. Don't go fast, or you will rip my hemorrhoids."
Can I just ask, when do you intend to get on Dark Souls?
I don't know. I just bought it. I put it on the pile of shame.
Because I did actually reactivate my Xbox account. I bought 3 months in advance because I figured it were going to take a while to get back on the horse.
Well,
it's matchmaking only, basically.
Yeah.
It matches you with somebody about 10 levels of where you are. But you can drop your summon sign wherever you want. Hmm. So basically, you drop your summon sign and it appears in everyone else's game. Ooh. And if they're human, they can look at this sign, glowing sign on the floor, and it'll say Dalek Sex on it. And you can click it and it will summon them into your game.
Ooh, that just sounds awesome. I've not booted the game up yet.
The idea is that in Lordran, time is distorted. Hmm. So sort of like people's timelines overlap with each other.
Sure.
And if you play it online, you will actually see other people's games taking place, but like in ghosted form over the top of yours. And the idea is you can reach... There's no party system and there's no lobby system, which is quite frustrating. You can't play with your friends without considerable effort.
Sure.
But the idea is that it's completely integrated to the game world. You are using your humanity to reach out and rip people out of their timelines.
Sure.
To help you. The goddess Velka is the goddess of sin and punishment, and you can buy a slip from the priest of Velka in the game called an indictment, and if somebody in-game griefs you or spams you or fucks you up on purpose in some way, you can use the slip to indict them, and then the player character group, the Blades of Darkmoon, play the Knights of Vengeance that will come and fuck sinners up. So not only is there a method to exact negative karma on shitty players, but it's actually the game community that will enforce it.
Ooh.
And you can roleplay as one of the Blades of Darkmoon. When you do this, it will match you against somebody who has been indicted by another player.
Jeez. I've got to get on that shit tonight. I shouldn't.
I was reading a few articles over the last few days on my travels, and two popped up. One was that someone had discovered, in inverted commas, I'm sure they haven't discovered it, but one of a few people who have found this side quest in Final Fantasy IX recently after, God, 13
years. Oh,
yeah,
I heard about that.
And there was a similar one linked in from that about a secret pirate ship on Blood Omen Legacy of Cain that someone had found after 15 years. Secret entrance into the back of a pub or whatever. Mm-hmm. And I think there was a comment later saying that we can expect in 10 years' time that people will find things in Dark Souls like this. Does that bear any...
I think there will, because there's people have got ripped the text dump out of the game and found stuff that wasn't used. Oh. When you come to creating a character, I have two pieces of advice for you. First of all, it matters not a fucking jot which starting class you pick.
Yeah.
Any class can be customized for anything. When you pick your starting gift, the only one that has any serious effect on the content of the game is the old witch's ring. If you don't have the old witch's ring, you won't be able to communicate with the Fair Lady of Chaos. And there's other gifts, like there's a key that chops, I don't know, about half an hour or an hour of gameplay off at the start. You might also want to pick the thief class.
Yep.
Because the thief class starts with that key as default and then picks a starting gift. So, in effect, gets two starting gifts.
This conversation is remarkable and coincidental, because this week we had Chris Beck send Newsbot a message trolling him.
At this point of the show, we enter our consultation zone. If you have any problems with your favourite games, drop in about them, and we'll get your queries answered by the man who knows more than anyone, the Games Boss.
I do not kidding believe it. How many times do I have to tell you? I am the resident agony uncle, not Games Master. Fuck. My. Luck. And Dominic Diamond is such a fucking cunt.
Dear Uncle Newsbot, open brackets, Games Master, close brackets. What starting gift should I choose in Dark Souls?
Jesus Christ. And Chris Beck of all people. Okay. Okay, just this once, fans. Just this once. Are you ready? Here's my tip for Dark Souls. Be a thief and wear the witch's ring. Now fuck off.
So thank you very much for that. How weird.
Miyazaki, no relation,
The
director of the game, says that if you are going to choose, if he were to choose any starting gift, it would be the pendant. The pendant does absolutely fuck all. It's just kind of a role-playing thing.
Yeah.
He didn't tell people that at the time. He just said, you should choose the pendant, and then later admitted that he was trolling. £9, you can't go wrong. I mean, it didn't drop below £40 for about a year after it was released. So getting it for £9 is just insane against value.
So, we've successfully done six shows, back to back. I think it's a record. It's not. I was listening to an old banter snatch that you and Bouncy did today. Yeah, it was nice, it was good. You were talking about Susan Boyle's marketeers thinking of using the hashtag...
Sue's Anal Bum Party.
Sue's Anal Bum Party.
Oh, good days. That's the best hashtag ever, with the possible exception of now that Scher's dead. Now Thatcher's dead.
Oh, shit.
Caused a similar misunderstanding.
Both tears of joy.
From my hox eye.
From your hox eye. Scher, who
No, not my hocksigh. Is that what... Oh, God, is that what you call it?
Well, that's not what I call it, but those closest to it like to... Those snuggling up to it, those putting their arm around it.
I bet they can see where you're coming from.
Hey!
If you've enjoyed the Lollocaust, why not try these other fine holiday destinations? Visit the picturesque Monday Movie Show, which has basically the only movie reviews worth a fuck now that Ebert's curled his feet up. Make a side journey to the quaint Gamescast to enjoy their fine wines, gaming chit-chat, and to meet Britain's only spherical human. On Friday, the circus comes to town, courtesy of the Mature Gamer podcast and its fascinating menagerie, including the coated man and the girl who can only communicate via sex noises. And for those of richer blood, no true connoisseur of burping and swearing at the internet can afford to miss What a Fool Believes, the web's second finest purveyors of aliens references and saying cunt a lot.